And you know that things are swinging all the time. Like an ocean that's in motion, like the wind that's blowing the boat right in the shore. It's the littlest thing that I can do. Things are swinging, they keep swinging more. Yes, things are swinging and they keep swinging more. Let's keep on swinging and swing right out the door.
Describe that to me, because that must come all from the vocals, or is it the movement on stage when you're singing these very sexy songs?
I don't know, but I like it. I don't know where it comes from, but it's lovely. I'll take that any day. More of that, thank you.
All right, well, here's another one from the list. Sheer class and haunting.
So oh, that's nice.
That's beautiful. I've seen Maria sing a number of times, and one of the things I've always wanted to do with you is sing a duet. With you. I'm not sure I'm actually up to scratch for this, but we'll need some music. So, would you please welcome to the stage Mr. Michael Topping? And I thought what we would do, Maria, I know it's really off the cuff and we haven't really practiced this. I'd love to do a song with you called Something Stupid. Is that okay? Yeah, do you know the song?
I do.
Okay. Because I know we only had 3 minutes to practice this before we started. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to introduce Maria Teche as my partner for Something Stupid.
I know I stand in line until you think you have the time to spend an evening with me.
He's gay.
When we go someplace to dance, I know that there's a chance you won't be leaving with me.
He's very gay.
And afterwards we drop into a quiet little place and have a drink or two.
Gay bar.
And then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like I love you.
Now the shape changes from year to year. This one's called The Godly Hour.
Yes.
Now, you've been around the world to get anecdotes from this, haven't you?
I do. Basically, I don't have a show for Edinburgh. Every year I turn up and I make the show up on the night. Because I don't have writers, producers or directors, because they cost money. So I just make the show up on the night and it makes me really nervous. And it's really, really good if you've ever been locked up. So, if I was a young guy with emotional hair and skinny jeans, they would say I was an improvising genius, but I'm quite an old woman and they just think I've got Alzheimer's. Well, she's forgot her show and did another one.
Our show is about love, finding it in various places, unusual places, and occasionally in a taxi. Must confide, I had rough trade in a taxi. One eye on the map, each leg in a strap. It was a very good ride. And though I'll admit, the driver was not at first happy, he His conscience I quelled when my tip he beheld. He showed me his seat and I sighed, ooh. Taxis, buses or cars, trains, motorbike and all bars. I've a list to be filled and a dish to be thrilled at speed. If you find it too much, put your hand on my clutch, then slip straight into gear. If your pistons are clear, proceed. How very gay, my knickers discarded with rapture. To capture such bliss, up the motorway fly. I came in a taxi tonight.
In addition to being a qualified doctor and a British Asian man, I am, like many tonight, an openly gay man. And as the only openly gay British Asian qualified doctor on the comedy circuit, as the only one, it's an interesting life. But as the press starts sniffing around, and they have no idea what to make of me, because I'm nobody's idea of a stereotypical gay man. So I get asked the lamest question. What's it like being gay? What's it like being gay and Asian? What's it like being a gay Asian doctor? What's it like being a gay Asian doctor comedian? And then the obsession with my parents. Are they proud that you're a doctor? Are they proud that you're a comedian? Do they know that you're gay? Do they know that you're Asian? Again, again and again and again. My dad, never gonna tell him. Then the Manchester Evening News publishes a photograph of my face underneath the headline, "The only gay Bengali doctor in the village." Suddenly, I'm in all kinds of trouble. My dad rings me up, says we need to chat. I'll go over, it's the big one. I have to come out to my dad. You've got to understand, in my dad's culture, being gay is literally the worst thing you can be. It's a status just below a leper and just above a gay leper. So here's the thing.
Is there any truth to the this line that apparently a racist called you a racist? How does that work?
A racist did call me a racist. That's the theme of the show. The show this year is called Extreme Anti-White Vitriol. And by accident, I ended up appearing on the radio last year with the deputy leader of the British National Party. I say by accident, I agreed to take part in a debate about the BNP, and then they told me after I'd said yes, oh, by the way, you'll be on with the deputy leader of the British National Party, which was a bit of a surprise to me, because I'm not actually a politician. I'm a stand-up comic. My political opinions are a mixture of pub banter and other people's Facebook status updates. I didn't necessarily feel qualified to talk. But then I started talking back to the guy, Simon Darby, and he said, well, what are you doing? You're meant to be a comedian. You haven't told a single joke yet. And I don't know what jokes he was expecting from me on the radio. An Englishman, an Englishman, an Englishman walking to a pub, that kind of thing. How many BNP members did take change a light bulb? None, they're terrified of change. I think that was the sort of thing.